manufacturing indices, exports, GST and other tax collections on almost all fronts. And I can speak for foreign trade, for example. Our exports are at an all-time high. We are at nearly $232 billion in the first 7 months, something we have never seen for many, many years. Last year, for the whole year, we were at $290 billion, and which I think we'll do in the first three quarters itself. Similarly, GST collection is at an all-time high of 1.3 lakh crores. The earlier high was in April of 2019, which was obviously reflecting the collections of the year-end month of March 19. Whereas this 1.3 lakh crores is a mid-year collection. Similarly, our PMI for manufacturing at 55 plus, our PMI for services at a decadal high of over 58, all signs, corporate profits, corporate valuations, everything seems to suggest that India is bounced back. The huge success of the vaccination program, 110 crore doses now. We have huge stocks at the states, so much so that we are now going into people's homes, approaching them at home through the Har Ghar Dastak program to try and attract people to get vaccinated, all those who are left behind or who haven't taken their second dose. We are well poised to make 500 crore vaccines in the next year. So we'll not only be completing our India's vaccination requirement, but in effect, contributing to saving the world. And large parts of the world, the less developed countries, developing nations, really are looking up to India's leadership to keep them safe and secure. So we have huge and ambitious plans on the anvil. So in some sense, I would say we've come back. However, as the Honorable Prime Minister very often says, we all have to be cautious. We cannot become over-adventurous. We have to maintain the COVID protocols of social distancing, be masked up all the time in public places, ensure personal hygiene at the highest level, and as far as possible, ensure that everybody in and around you, or your workplace or your home, gets the double dose of vaccine quickly. I just pray and hope that, like your Times Now summit last year was just at the cusp of when the COVID-19 hit India, I hope this Times Now summit heralds the end of COVID-19.
I hope so too. I hope so too, and we all hope so. The question many people ask is, was a complete lockdown? I know it's a little bit of revisiting of that decision, health-wise, maybe the right thing to do at that time, but was it a knee-jerk reaction? From the economy point of view, and are we paying the price, for a long time that it's taken for the economy to recover?
Navika ji, I can assure you, we are blessed to have a leader like Prime Minister Modi who doesn't take knee-jerk decisions ever. Every one of his decisions is a well thought out, very well discussed with experts and all stakeholders, and very well thought of decision. I recall that Prime Minister Modi would spend, I would say, nights on end studying about prior history of epidemics and pandemics. He went as far back as the Spanish flu 100 years ago to study what models helped different nations. And I think he even went to the extent of doing comparative analysis of nations which focused on protecting their economies over the health of their citizens and other nations which saved the lives of their citizens, even at the cost of a short-term compromise on the economy. He went to that extent of research and study. And just look back in time. After all, it's very easy in hindsight to try and question a decision made 19 months ago or 20 months ago. But just imagine, we had started with one, and when we went into lockdown in 2020, we had only four centers in the country. which could do testing. Maybe 2,500 tests a day, ma'am. We had no PPE manufacturing, personal protective equipment, anywhere in India. Rapid testing kits were just not available. There was very little spare capacity to handle the COVID load which could have come up, and which was rapidly rising in other parts of the world, causing huge overwhelming of health infrastructure. Obviously, there was no cure for that matter. There was not even a protocol to handle somebody down with COVID. I remember a conversation with Dr. Trehan just before the lockdown, where he told me, I have some 400 PPE kits. At that time, he was using a PPE kit for one patient, one visit, because nobody knew what the protocol was. And there was scare that if a doctor goes or a nurse goes and with a PPE kit and sees one patient, they have to scrap that PPE kit and change into another before seeing another patient. These are all learnings that have come over the period. So at that point of time, if we had not gone in for a strict lockdown and really controlled the situation, bought us some time, those crucial 3 months, to ramp up our testing facility, to take technology to the next level so that we could have technological solutions to handle the crisis better. Start developing vaccines. And you know, we were amongst the first countries in the world to invest and promote vaccine development at 6 places at a time. Start preparing our Indian industry, and I'm proud of the textile sector, which really ramped up very rapidly in association with defense. The DRDO played a very important role to start becoming self-sufficient, and today, a large exporter of PPEs. We are the world's second largest manufacturer of PPEs. We make our own rapid testing kits in India. We make our own testing equipment or testing ingredients in India. And we are today testing what? Over 3 million tests sometimes in a day. 30 lakh tests per day. Where 2,500? Where 30 lakh. And I believe testing is going on in thousands of locations all over the country. Vaccination. We would be the only country in the world to have probably 5 or 6 vaccines. And the world's first DNA vaccine. The first nasal spray vaccine. We would soon have an RNA vaccine, mRNA vaccine, just like Pfizer and Moderna from India. And much more efficient than those, because those are required to be stored at 70 to 80 degrees, -70 to 80 degrees. Our vaccine is at -8 to 10 degrees, or 2 to 10 degrees. So really, in every sense of the term, we have found solutions which are relevant to India. And that 3 months of lockdown and the consistent and continued effort over the last 20 months, led by a decisive leader, leading from the front, hands-on leader, has helped save India and this huge bounce back that we see today.
Mr. Piyush Goyal, we spoke a lot about Atmanirbharta, local for vocal. This was at a time when we had Galwan and there was this whole campaign on banning Chinese goods. Where are we today on the export, import and the trade situation with China?
First of all, let me tell you, any of our policies are never based on one country or one region. They're always based on principles. India is a proud participant of the transparent, rules-based, fair and equitable multilateral trading system. And all our rules, regulations, restrictions, policies, procedures are equal to all countries. So at the outset, let me share with you that as far as trade goes, we have been most fair in our trade with all countries. Our Atmanirbhar Bharat program is the need of the hour to make India more self-sufficient, as well as prepare ourselves to engage with the rest of the world from a position of strength. Atmanirbhar Bharat is not about closing India's doors to international engagement. On the contrary, we are opening our doors wider for greater degree of engagement with the whole world so that we can attract investments, technology, more trade and goods and services. And to my mind, we have been fairly successful in that. Very often, imports also are necessary. They reflect the growing strength of Indian industry. Let me give you two or three examples. We would not have been able to become a world leader in renewable energy if in the initial stages, we had not imported equipment at affordable prices to keep our renewable energy affordable to the common man. But today, because of that, we have successfully pioneered renewable energy in India, and now we see Indian manufacturing expanding rapidly. Similarly, on healthcare, we got a lot of equipment support from all over the world, which has helped us become a powerhouse in India. On the pharmaceutical products, we import a lot of equipment, sometimes technology, but that has helped us become the pharmacy of the world. When we export over $10-12 billion of steel, we certainly need coking coal, which is in short supply in India, so we'll need to import. If we want to keep edible oil prices reasonable, we'll have to get palm oil, which is not available in India. And we are still dependent on imports for about 65% of our oil seeds, for which Prime Minister has recently approved and launched the oil seeds mission to move towards Atmanirbhar Bharat on oil seed, on edible oils. So it's a holistic program targeting a well-being of 130 crore Indians. And I think we are moving very rapidly towards that.
Mr. Goyal, many people from the common man perspective may not be able to appreciate the acronyms that exist, WTO, Quad, Quad number two, FTAs. I want to ask you a question to explain this to our normal viewers on what India's policy is on all of these forums and how is India going to protect its own interests in negotiations at these fora where there are larger countries, larger interests of the developed world versus the developing world.
Prime Minister Modi has truly created an impact across the world about India's strengths. I had the privilege of being with him at the G20 recently. And I can tell you, it is truly very, very invigorating to see the kind of respect that today India gets from the top leaders of the world. Because, as Prime Minister Modi said in one of his interventions at the G20, the whole world saw an India which they could trust. At the peak of the pandemic, even during the lockdown, India met every one of its commitments to the world, be it in goods or in services. I remember when the lockdown was being imposed, decisions were being taken within hours how to help industry or our IT sector and other service providers relocate to their homes, providing broadband internet connectivity overnight, but ensuring that not a single second, ladies and gentlemen, not for one second, did any international service commitment of India fail. And the whole world has observed this. And which is why today they look at India as a trusted partner. When you work with India, you can trust India. And truly, when you see that kind of feedback from other world leaders, when in their interventions, they refer to Prime Minister Modi, or as Mr. Boris Johnson said, there's one earth, one sun, one grid, and one Narendra.
But
it makes us proud that today the world recognizes India as an emerging superpower, but also recognizes us as a resilient economy, a trusted trade partner. through the FTAs and these quads, we are trying to strengthen these strengths of India. Through free trade agreements, we are looking at reciprocal and equitable access to foreign markets. And always remember, a free trade agreement is a win-win for both countries or both sets of countries. If it is an unequal balance, a free trade agreement can never be successful. We've had some old free trade agreements which were so unbalanced that it only landed up increasing our trade deficit. We are now going through careful stakeholder engagement, making sure our MSMEs, our dairy, our farmers, our domestic production capacities are protected, they get more opportunity. Our employment-oriented sectors like textile, footwear, pharmaceutical get good market access. We are ensuring our services sector, especially considering India has a huge pool of trained manpower and competent managerial skills, they get good opportunities with our trading partners. So through a lot of two-way communication with Indian stakeholders, we are working through balanced, fair, and equitable trade agreements so that both sides benefit, jobs are created in India, business opportunities are available for our small industry, medium-sized industry, or micro-industry. India's textiles, handicrafts, handlooms, footwear, leather accessories, dairy, agricultural products, food products, medical products, all of these get larger market footprint. And through the Quad engagement, we are looking at strategic partnerships. After all, when we want to expand our trade and business, it's also important that we are friends. And friendships are sought to be strengthened and institutionalized through our defense partnership, through our strategic partnership, through our partnership on socio-economic parameters. And all in all, ladies and gentlemen, you can be proud that today India has emerged as the leader of the less developed countries and the developing world. Prime Minister Modi today is the voice of the less developed countries and developing world, but sits on the high table with the developed countries as a respected and tall leader representing 130 crore Indians, all of you.
Mr. Piyush Goyal, what is our stand as a country, as a government, on trade with China, especially after Galwan? I'm asking you this question in another manner, only because people of India often question that trade increases with China despite Galwan, despite the fact that we talked about Atmanirbharta vis-a-vis China. Where do we stand with China?
Well, as I said, India believes in multilateral free trade, and we are part of the larger committee of nations where we all have certain rules of trading. For us, it's important that we strengthen domestic capacities. We strengthen the culture of quality in India to make high quality products. We strengthen the awareness amongst people of India how important it is both to produce good quality products, but also to be competitive, to be able to provide products which are in the interests of consumers. And to my mind, over the last 1 year, we've seen growth with almost every country, both in imports and exports. As I said, in exports, we're going to grow from 290 billion to 400 billion this year, including our exports to almost every part of the world. Similarly, our imports will grow. On the one hand, petroleum products have become very expensive worldwide. Other commodities are ruling at very high prices. So we do expect imports also to grow. But a large part of our imports are products where either we don't produce sufficiently in India, or we have a requirement for them as raw material, or as machineries, or as products which are processed and re-exported from India. So as I said earlier, all imports are not necessarily bad. But one has to strengthen India's domestic capabilities. And that is what Prime Minister Modi has been focusing on through the Make in India program over the last several years. We've now introduced production-linked incentives in nearly 13 very, very important manufacturing sectors, identified in close partnership with Indian industry. So we actually had an industry-led initiative called the Steering Committee for Advancement of Local Manufacturing and Employment and Export Opportunities. This scale committee, led by the private sector, came out with the cost disabilities or wherever we need to become more competitive and came up with the PLI scheme. And as you are aware, it's been a runaway success so far. So all of these will help create jobs in India, create working opportunities, build a larger manufacturing ecosystem at scale so that we are cost competitive and also make us more export worthy or ready to engage with the world. And to my mind, our story is a long-term story. We are not looking at only the short-term gains or the short-term impact of any of these policies. These are really long-term transformational initiatives that have been started by the government. हमारे वोट कितने बड़े पैमाने पे बड़े ऐसे ही आसाम में हम पांचों सीटें जीते मध्य प्रदेश में ऐतिहासिक विजय हुई तो ये अलग अलग जगह की अलग अलग परिस्थिति के हिसाब से हमें वोट भी मिले हैं जीते भी हैं आपने अगर लोकल बॉडीज के देखे होंगे चुनाव जम्मू कश्मीर तक में हम सिंगल लार्जेस्ट पार्टी बने थे गांधीनगर में पिछली बार हमें कितनी कम सीटें मिली थी लोकल बॉडी चुनाव में अब शायद 44 में से 42 सीटें भारतीय जनता पार्टी लोकल बॉडी में जीती तो ये अलग अलग स्थितियों के हिसाब से चुनावी रिजल्ट्स आए हैं और मैं समझता हूँ एट दी एग्रीगेट भारतीय जनता पार्टी का परफॉर्मेंस ऐतिहासिक रहा है डिटेल में जाए तो ध्यान में आते हैं कि कैसे किसान आंदोलन के बावजूद हरियाणा तक में अगर हरियाणा का चुनाव अगर आप परिपेक्ष में देखें तो उनकी सिटिंग सीट थी INLD की वो पिछली बार 55,000 वोट से शायद जीते थे अब 5-7,000 वोट से जीते हैं तो एक प्रकार से तो सिद्ध करता है कि जिस राज्य में सो कॉल्ड इतना बड़ा आंदोलन चल रहा है और हमें नुकसान होना चाहिए था वहां भी हमारा वोट बड़ा है भारतीय जनता पार्टी का
कैप्टन अमरिंदर सिंह ने आपको मदद ऑफर करी है किसानों के साथ ब्रेक थ्रू के लिए क्या आप वो मदद लेंगे
हम तो सबकी मदद लेंगे नाविका जी आप भी मदद करिए क्योंकि हम सभी को अपने भाई बहन मानते हैं किसानों की जितनी चिंता माननीय प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी के राज में हुई है इतनी तो शायद 70 साल में उसके पहले कभी नहीं हुई 2014 के बाद आप एक के बाद एक माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी के निर्णय देख लीजिए MS स्वामीनाथन जी तक का लेख है शायद आपके सिस्टर पब्लिकेशन टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया में आप निकाल के देखिए उन्होंने कहा किसी सरकार ने किसानों के लिए इतना काम नहीं किया जितना प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी ने किया MSP को लागत से 1.5 गुना गारंटी करना कितनी बड़ी बात प्रधानमंत्री जी ने की आज MSP के जो प्राइजेस आप देखेंगे ऐतिहासिक बढ़त हुई है MSP प्राइजेस में अगर खरीद देखेंगे तो वो तो आपके अगर ग्राफ बनाने जाओगे तो टीवी स्क्रीन के बाहर ग्राफ चले जाएगा
तो लिखित में दे दीजिए यही तो मांग रहे हैं किसान
तो हमने तो हाउस में अनाउंस कर दिया है कि MSP की जो प्रक्रिया है वो यथा जो आज चल रही है वो वही प्रक्रिया आगे भी चलती रहेगी और कोई उसको रोकेगा नहीं किसी प्रकार की उसमें रोक नहीं है और ये कानून में तो किधर जिक्र भी नहीं है MSP का शब्द भी नहीं है और MSP को रोकने की ना किसकी मंशा है और ना इस कानून में कोई प्रावधान है ये कानून के बारे में कुछ भ्रम फैलाने में कुछ लोग सफल हुए दुर्भाग्य है कि कुछ लोग गलत फहमियों के कारण आज भी इन कानूनों का विरोध कर रहे हैं मैं समझता हूं कि आपके माध्यम से और आज आपके प्लेटफॉर्म से मैं सभी को अनुरोध करूंगा कि माननीय तोमर जी ने और मैंने माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी के आशीर्वाद से एक बहुत अच्छा प्रस्ताव उनके समक्ष रखा था, उस पर चर्चा करने आए। उसमें अगर कुछ और कमी ज़्यादा लगती है तो हम तैयार है बात करने, लेकिन बातचीत तत्वों के आधार पर होती है, बातचीत इश्यूज पर होती है। बातचीत सिर्फ एक तरफा और एक डिमांड को लेके कि बस ये करो नहीं तो और कुछ हमें मंजूर नहीं है, और बिना कोई रीज़न या लॉजिक के कोई बात करने से तो हल नहीं निकल सकता है। और बाकी जो मदद करना चाहे सभी का स्वागत है। मैं चाहूँगा कि आप भी इसमें थोड़ी पहल करें।
पीयूष जी, मदद तो आपको चाहिए क्योंकि एक साल होने को आ रहा है कि किसान है कि मानते ही नहीं, और पॉलिटिशियन जो होते हैं आपकी तरह, राजनीतिक दल जो होते हैं उन्हें चुनाव लड़ने पड़ते हैं और आ रहे हैं उत्तर प्रदेश के चुनाव। आपके हिसाब से उत्तर प्रदेश चुनाव से पहले क्या ये अनिवार्य नहीं कि ये प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व हो, नहीं तो इलेक्शन में इसका खामियाजा आपको भुगतना पड़ेगा?
पहली बात तो मैंने पहले भी जिक्र किया, प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी का हम सब के लिए स्पष्ट निर्देश है कि हमें जनता ने चुन के सेवा करने के लिए भेजा है, ना कि कोई चुनाव के लिए तैयारी करने के लिए पूरे समय निर्णय लेने के लिए भेजा है। जो सख्त कदम और कई बार कठोर कदम माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी ने उठाए हैं वो शायद ही और किसी के दल के पास इतना राजकीय पॉलिटिकल कैपिटल होगा या इतनी हिम्मत होगी ऐसे कदम उठाने की। लेकिन प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी पूरे समय दिन और काम में जुटे रहते हैं। चुनाव में उत्तर प्रदेश के लोग देखेंगे कैसे प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी की केंद्र सरकार, राज्य में योगी जी की सरकार ने मिलके वास्तव में एक डबल इंजन की सरकारें देके जो गति विकास की तेज की है, जो आज कानून व्यवस्था वहाँ पे अच्छी बनाई है, जिस प्रकार से तेज गति से डेवलपमेंट हुआ है, चाहे वो इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर का हो, मैन्युफैक्चरिंग और इंडस्ट्री का हो, जिस प्रकार से पूरे प्रदेश में अलग अलग व्यवस्थाओं के माध्यम से एमएसएमई सेक्टर को लाभ पहुंचाया है, इंडस्ट्री को प्रमोट करने की कोशिश की है, एक्सपोर्ट को बहुत बल दिया है, वन डिस्ट्रिक्ट वन प्रोडक्ट शायद उत्तर प्रदेश में सबसे ज़्यादा सक्सेसफुल रहा है। हाल में ही मैंने लॉजिस्टिक्स की एक रिपोर्ट निकाली थी, लॉजिस्टिक्स में लोगों ने कैसा काम किया, सरलता कितनी लाई, खर्चे कितने कम हुए, उत्तर प्रदेश ने सबसे अच्छा काम किया, सीधा सातवें या नौवें अंक से दूसरे अंक पे आ गए। तो मैं समझता हूँ कि उत्तर प्रदेश के चुनावी नतीजे बहुत अच्छे आएंगे। भारतीय जनता पार्टी हमारे मित्र पक्षों के साथ वहाँ फिर एक बार पूर्ण बहुमत की और अच्छी बहुमत की सरकार लेके आएगी। किसानों के आंदोलन को रिजॉल्व करना कोई उत्तर प्रदेश चुनाव से संबंधित विषय नहीं है, वो तो हम वैसे भी करना चाहते हैं, जल्द से जल्द करना चाहते हैं। हम तो कल तैयार हैं बातचीत के लिए। अगर वो बातचीत में विषयों के ऊपर चर्चा करके और इसको जल्द से जल्द हल करें तो हमारा स्वागत है। चर्चा के लिए आए, बातचीत करके समाधान की तरफ जल्द से जल्द हो, इसका चुनाव से कोई संबंध नहीं है।
वेल, ऑन दैट नोट आई थिंक द मिनिस्टर फॉर बीइंग सो फोर्थराइट, सो ओपन एंड गिविंग अ सेंस ऑफ डायरेक्शन इन विच इंडिया इज मूविंग फॉर द नेक्स्ट 25 इयर्स। अ बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज फॉर यूनियन मिनिस्टर Piyush Goyal, thank you very much for joining us here at the Times Now Summit. Energy kam kyun hai? Tez taaliyan honi chahiye. Well, let's now move on with updates.